From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Hello, and welcome to the Book Festival on Sunday. As usual, we have a great lineup for you today. My name is Bill Lafergy, and I'm a manager and archivist in the library's National Digital Information Infrastructure and Preservation Program. My office helps people and institutions keep significant data into the future, in spite of whatever changes technology brings about. And speaking of technological progress, I have the honor of introducing Dr. Mario Livio, who will speak about his new book, Brilliant Blunders, From Darwin to Einstein, Colossal Mistakes by Great Scientists That Changed Our Understanding of Life and the Universe. The book is a lively and fascinating read. It does an excellent job illustrating how humanity's march towards progress takes a decidedly meandering path. Dr. Livio is a senior astrophysicist at the Hubble Space Telescope Science Institute in Baltimore. In addition to his distinguished academic career, Dr. Livio is a renowned writer of popular books about science and mathematics. He has a special talent to explain very complicated issues to a general audience. Dr. Livio is also among the rare scientists to have been interviewed by Jon Stewart on The Daily Show, where he appeared earlier this month. One final statement that I'm required to read. This event is being videotaped for subsequent broadcast on the library's website and other media. The audience is encouraged to offer comments and raise questions during the formal question and answer period, but please be advised that your voice and or image may be recorded and later broadcast as part of this event. By participating in the question and answer period, you are consenting to the library's possible reproduction and transmission of your remarks. Dr. Livio.
Thank you very much. I was very happy that my event turned out to be today rather than yesterday when it rained like crazy. Let me just first apologize. I mean, I actually requested and was promised to be able to use my laptop and project something, but apparently that's available only in the children's pavilion and not here. So I'll just talk. The second thing is that there is a lot of noise here. I was going to use a lapel mic because I have ADHD. I need to walk all the time. But even that did not work because it wasn't just powerful enough. So I have to now be stuck at the podium. So if you will suddenly see me starting to dance or something, it's because of my ADHD. Let me tell you a little bit about Brilliant Blunders. So in Brilliant Blunders, what I've done is I've chosen five giant scientists. And the five are actually Charles Darwin, Lord Kelvin, Linus Pauling, Fred Hoyle, and Albert Einstein. So these are luminaries on anybody's list of great scientists, but for each one of them, I've chosen one major blunder that they have made. And I discuss their work from the perspective of these blunders. Now, why have I done that? Why have I done it with talking about blunders? So the first thing I wanted to do is, basically to make it easier for the rest of us. I mean, not just we make mistakes, but even the greatest scientific luminaries make big mistakes. So that's kind of a comforting thought. The second and main reason had to do with the fact that the way science is usually presented, you get the impression that science is a pure success story. It's a direct march to the truth. Of course Einstein had to come up with general relativity. What else could he have come up with? But in fact, nothing can be further from the truth. Science really progresses, and in fact, not just science, but all creative processes progress by a series of, you know, it's a zigzag with lots of blind alleys, lots of false starts, and so on. And I wanted to convey this part. And this is very important because we have become somewhat a society that does not tolerate very well blunders or mistakes. The thing is, you see, it's not an accident that I called the book Brilliant Blunders. This is to distinguish them from sloppy blunders or from careless blunders. So I'm not advocating that people should be sloppy in their science or their work or whatever, but I am advocating thinking outside the box. And when you think outside the box, then you know, you have to take some calculated risks, and there is the possibility that, yes, you will blunder. You may blunder. But you also have the potential reward of getting to a real breakthrough. You know, in mathematics, there is something like this that, you know, if you are at some sort of a minimum, you're at some place, and if you try to do just some tiny change, in the way that you would do if you try to have incremental progress, there is no way to get out of that hole. You need what mathematicians call a finite amplitude perturbation to get you out of there, which means you really need to have some sort of thinking that is unconventional. And this is how sometimes you get to great breakthroughs, and not by, you know, just doing only incremental science. This is not to say anything against incremental science. This is part of how progress in science works. But occasionally you have to take those risks. And when taking those risks, you also increase your probability of making a blunder. Now, I want to just spend a few minutes now talking about one of these people, say, just to give you an idea of how this book progresses and what this is all about and so on. So let's take Charles Darwin, because everybody knows who he is. And so Charles Darwin came up with this theory of evolution by means of natural selection. What does that mean? In one blow, he changed the entire picture of biology. And he had four main pillars that support his theory, and they are supported by one big mechanism. Had I actually been able to project something here, I would have shown you there are these pictures that come from Indian myths that have nothing to do with Darwin, where you see that the world is supported by four elephants who stand on one giant turtle. So it's a very good metaphor for Darwin's theory of evolution by means of natural selection. But by the way, as an aside, there is a story that's almost certainly apocryphal, but it's such a good story that it's worth telling, even if it's not true. It's about Sir Bertrand Russell, who once gave a talk like this and said that, you know, there are these elephants, they stand on a giant turtle and this, and some lady asked him, and on what does that giant turtle stand on? And according to the story, he said, on yet another giant turtle. She said, and on what does that giant turtle stand on? She said, yet one more giant turtle. She said, and what does that say? He said, lady, I'm afraid from there is turtles all the way down. Now, he almost certainly didn't say it, but it's a very good story. Now, what are the four pillars? The four pillars are, first of all, the concept of evolution in itself. Namely, species are not immutable, as people always thought before him. Namely, it's not that species were formed once and they exist till today. In fact, most species become extinct, and until, you know, they evolve to the things we see today. Overall, you know, over the entire history of life on Earth, most of the species that ever existed became extinct. So this was the first point. A second point was gradualism. He borrowed this idea from the geologist, his friends. Lyell, in particular, was a famous geologist, was Darwin's personal friend. That's the idea that changes occur very slowly, as in geology. It's not that you can watch one species and it turns into another species in front of your eyes. hundreds of thousands of generations have to pass, just in the way that the Earth itself evolves very, very gradually. So that was the second point. Then there was the point of common ancestor. Namely, Darwin came up with this incredible idea that all life form on Earth, they all actually started from one life form. And this is how things evolved. And finally, though, and by the way, that is the basis of what we do today when we try to study origin of life. When we try to talk about origin of life, what we mean by that life originated in one way, and that was it. Everything we see is that. And finally, there is speciation, which is how do you get the diversity that we see in life? You see, when you think about life on Earth, the two things that strike you most, I mean, and you don't have to be a scientist to be struck by that, the first one is diversity. Just look around you here. What you see here is people. There is a person there walking his dog. There are insects flying in the air. There are all these plants. There are birds in the sky and all that. You know, we don't even know how many species there are on Earth. The latest estimate puts it at 8.7 million. But there may be many more. It could be anywhere between 5 and 100 million species. So that's one thing, enormous diversity. Second thing that you see on life on Earth is adaptation, an incredible degree of adaptation. You know, the bee has just the size that it can get into the flowers from which it feeds, and then, you know, pollen gets onto its body and she transfers it to other bodies. So these were two things were the reason that until Darwin, people thought, oh, there has to be some sort of a designer behind all of this. You know, it all, how can it be all so nicely adapted and so on? Darwin said, no, the way it happened, how do you get this speciation? By branching or splitting. Namely, you have a certain species and then it splits into two. And then you have another splitting. And so by the time you split lots of times, you know, you actually get to a situation where you have all these millions of species that we now see on Earth. One important point maybe to make here. Evolution is not a ladder. It's a bush. Humans are not at the top of anything. We're just as evolved as any other species that coexists with us. We just evolved in a different direction. It's like a bush. Okay, so all of this is fantastic, and Darwin explained everything on life on Earth with this theory. Where is his blunder? Everything sounds perfect. Well, his blunder has to do with the thing of heredity. Now, first, let's say that his theory, as I said, all these pillars were supported by one mechanism, which was natural selection. Natural selection, you know, there is this philosopher, Daniel Dennett, who said that he thought that natural selection was the best single idea anybody has ever had. It's very simple, actually, when it's pointed out to you. And the idea is the following, that if a certain member of a species or a certain species has a certain characteristic that gives it somehow an advantage, and if that characteristic is inheritable and can be passed on to the offspring, then over time, the population is going to change towards that type of characteristic. That's the idea. Now, at the time of Darwin, nobody knew genetics, and that included Darwin. Darwin, therefore, adopted the theory of genetics that was available at his time, which was blending heredity, namely the characteristics of the mother and the father get blended in the offspring, just like you would mix paints. Yes, or gin and tonic, or you know, any such thing. Yes, you take white and black, you mix them together, you get gray. We cannot blame Darwin for that was wrong. But what we can blame him for, or rather, this is his blunder, is that he did not realize that if these were truly the mechanism of heredity, natural selection could never have worked at all the way he envisaged it. Because think about this for a second. Let's suppose that you have a population of 1 million white cats and there is one black cat. And let's suppose that it is being black that confers this advantage that Darwin was talking about. But what's going to happen under blending heredity? This black cat is going to mate with a white cat, and they will get a gray cat. Black has already disappeared. This gray cat will mate with another white cat. You will get an even paler shade of gray. There is no way that after any amount of time, all of a sudden, the population of cats will turn black. In fact, black has disappeared after one generation. And Darwin somehow didn't get that. Partly because he was kind of weak on mathematics. He was. So whenever he tried the mathematical calculation, he managed somehow to botch it. So he was not very good in mathematics. Now, so this mistake was pointed out by an engineer, Fleming Jenkin, and Darwin became very worried about this. And he became worried enough that in a number of places, he comes awfully close to understanding how genetics really works. And the person who did discover how genetics really works was Gregor Mendel. And Mendel discovered that it's not like mixing of paints. It's like shuffling together decks of cards. You know, if I have an ace in my hand, I can shuffle as much as you want. I'll still have the ace. That's how genes work. The genes are indestructible. They can pass on and continue on and do their thing. So that is the thing that Darwin lacked. But in several of his letters, he actually came awfully close to understanding that, only just couldn't quite get his head quite around this. He writes in one letter he wrote to Wallace, which is just amazing, and it is so simple that you think, how did nobody else think of that? He writes to Wallace, he said, listen, isn't it strange that from any male or female in the world, you get a distinct male or female, and not some intermediate hermaphrodite? If blending heredity would have worked, that's what you should have gotten. So he realized that it cannot be that, but he just couldn't figure out what it actually was. Now, there is one thing I like to do. Anyone of you who either have read or would like to read the book would realize that I've put an just incredible amount of research into it. I'm a research scientist, and the part I like best is the research part. So I put a lot of research into all of my books, and this one more than in any other. And there have been no fewer than four books that claimed that, you see, Mendel's paper on heredity, on the way genes work, he did these experiments with peas, yellow peas, green peas, and so on, appeared in 1865. Darwin's letter to Wallace, at least one of them, was in 1866. So there are four books that claimed that Darwin must have read Mendel's paper, that he did not get it by himself, that heredity must work in a different way, that he read it in Mendel's paper. So I decided to look really into it. Could it have been that? And in fact, there is a guy, Andrew Sclater from the Darwin Project, that looked into this even before me. So I was helped by his work. So how did Darwin know about Mendel's work? So, okay, let me make the record straight here. First of all, Mendel's paper did not exist in Darwin's possession. I mean, we know everything that Darwin had at the time he died, and he did not have a copy of Mendel's paper, which is not surprising because it appeared in some journal in Brünn, which Darwin was not subscribed to and which was fairly obscure. Okay, but maybe he had some texts which described Mendel's work. So you look at, again, everything in Darwin's possession, and you find out that there were two books in Darwin's possession that mentioned Mendel. And in particular, the claim has been that in one of these books written by one named Fokke, the description was there, and therefore Darwin could have read it there. Well, I actually asked for that book, for Darwin's book of Fokke, to be brought to me. I was in Cambridge and they brought me this book. And you know what I discovered? Do you remember that in old books, the pages were glued at the top and you had to cut them open? The pages where Mendel's experiments are described in Darwin's book were never cut. So Darwin never read that book at all. And let me tell you something. Had he even read that book, he would not have been particularly illuminated, because Fokke himself did not understand anything from Mendel's experiments. So Darwin did not know anything about Mendel's work. Mendel, by the way, did know about Darwin's work. And you see in quite a bit of his writing a strong influence of Darwin. In some places, almost even the language is almost the same language. And basically what we know today is that Darwinian evolution and Mendelian genetics, they really need each other. They work together for the theory of evolution by means of natural selection that we have today, and they could not have worked one without the other. Now, I would like to actually try to stop here for a bit. I'm happy to talk a little bit more if you want, but see if you have any questions and things which you would like to discuss, and let's see how that goes. If there are no questions, I'll tell you a little bit more. So any questions here? Yes, I heard somebody asking about Einstein's blunder. Yes.
Why is it still a theory?
Evolution?
Why isn't
it a theory of why is evolution a theory and not a proven fact? I would say, you know, anything, general relativity is also a theory. You see, in science, we only have theories, right? Because the way science progresses is that every theory is considered true until it is falsified. And we can never prove a theory, you know, if you ever read Karl Popper or somebody like this, you can never prove a theory true. You can only prove it false. So basically, yes, Darwin's theory of evolution by means of natural selection is a fantastic theory which agrees with all known facts. So it is absolutely, our best theory for how life on Earth formed and evolved. Yes, but, you know, if tomorrow somebody will come and discover a rabbit from 2 billion years ago, it will destroy the theory of evolution. Okay, nobody yet discovered that. As far as we can tell from the fossil record, you go from primitive life to evolved life. But it would have been very easy to destroy the theory of evolution if you found things out of sequence. We haven't. Somebody asked about Einstein, so let me say something about Einstein. So Einstein, of course you have to read the book in a way, but let me just say very briefly. Einstein proposed the theory of general relativity, in which the idea was that gravity is not some mysterious force that acts across distance, but rather it is a feature of space and time. That masses, they distort space and warp it. In the same way that, you know, if I stand on a trampoline, I cause it to sag. So the fact that the mass of the sun is there, it causes space around it to warp. And then the planets, they just find the shortest paths in that warped space that gravity creates. Now, so that's general relativity. Now, when Einstein tried to apply this theory to the universe as a whole, at the time, in 1917, he thought that everything in the universe was static. Nothing is moving. There was no evidence for anything moving. But he said, but that's not possible because everything attracts everything else. So in the absence of anything, an opposing force, just the universe would collapse, right? Everything attracts everything else. This thing would collapse under its own weight. So what did he do? He added a term to his equations, and that term introduced, if you like, it's a fudge factor that he introduced, at least at the time, but introduced the term that did a repulsive force that precisely balanced gravity at every point. So these two masses attract each other, but there is also a repulsive force that exactly balances that. Now, it turns out it was not a great idea in the first place, to be honest, because that equilibrium that he tried to do was like balancing a pen on your finger, which is an unstable equilibrium. Yes, you can do it, but the slightest deviation, you know, it falls off. But it was not a good idea to create a static universe, but that term was allowed by general relativity. Then in 1929, the late 1920s, Edwin Hubble and others discovered that our universe is in fact expanding. It's not static. Everything moves away. So then Einstein said, well, wait a second. If everything is expanding, then I don't really need to balance everything precisely, because all that gravity would do, it would just slow down the expansion. Here, let me do what I didn't succeed in doing in John Stuart because I couldn't find my keys. So I throw my keys up, and the gravity up here slows them down, right? And in this case, the core is going to come down, right? Let's see. So Einstein then removed that term from his equations because he said, the universe expanding, I don't need to balance everything. He removed it. Great. Until 1998. In 1998, we discovered that the expansion of our universe is speeding up. It's accelerating. It's not slowing down. It's speeding up. Imagine, again, my keys. So, what is causing that acceleration? You know what? To the best of what we understand right now, it's that term that Einstein took out from his equations. That's what's causing it, yes? Well, John Stuart said it was my keys, but yeah. But so, it's that term that causes this acceleration, as far as we can tell. So, if you like, his blunder was not putting that term in, but actually taking it out. But this is what we now discovered. So, I mean, you know, when Einstein makes a blunder, it's such a blunder that it turns out to be a deep insight rather than a blunder. So, any other questions? Yes.
There's a microphone over here.
Sorry about that. Can you talk about some of the common causes of blunders? You talked about maybe an example of Darwin's blunder being a lack of understanding of the mathematics involved. What are maybe some more common causes of the other blunders that you have studied? The common causes of those blunders, yes.
Yeah, no, I couldn't hear if you said common or comic. But by the way, believe it or not, I was actually supposed to be on Colbert on Thursday, but they canceled last minute. what are more of the common causes? So the five people I've chosen, let me say what is common among them and what is not so common among them. So why did I choose these five? The reason I chose these five, there were a number of reasons, but I'll give you a couple of them. So one is that they are all giant scientists. I mean, I didn't want to choose, you know, if I choose my own blunders, you know, who cares, right? I mean, when people used to ask me while I was writing the book, what is the book about? I used to say it's about blunders and it's not an autobiography. So I chose five giant scientists. But there is something else that connects them, and that is actually the concept of evolution. This is evolution of life on Earth, evolution of the Earth itself, evolution of stars, and the evolution of the universe as a whole. So the concept of evolution runs through all of my people. Now, about the causes for their blunders. So they are actually somewhat different, but in two of the cases, I'd say that there is a certain level of falling victim to previous success. Namely, in the case of Linus Pauling in particular and Lord Kelvin, I mean, they were so successful in everything they did up to a certain point that you get a certain level of hubris, and you also get a certain level of where you start to believe that your original hunches are always correct and you shouldn't worry about details because those will work out at the end. And that happened in at least two cases. Yes.
Having read your book, I appreciate your comment about your extensive research. I found your discussion of the notes section almost as compelling a read as the book itself.
Thank you.
I hope to present you with the shortest question you've ever had.
Yes.
That question is this. Higgs?
Higgs, yes, we found it. If you're asking me, have we found it? The answer is yes. Even though they haven't determined the spin yet, I believe they actually have determined already. I was actually at the Large Hadron Collider 3 weeks ago. They have determined already that the spin is integer. It is not half a unit. And it will almost certainly turn out to be spin zero, I think, as we have predicted. So I believe they have found the Higgs.
And what does it mean for us today?
So it's the first example where you can have something a bit like Einstein's cosmological constant, where you have a field that permeates the entire universe, and it actually gives mass to all the particles that we know and love. So it's a bit like, you see, I don't know who is the most famous author that is here today. You probably know at the festival today, who is the most famous? Does anybody know? I don't know. Let's suppose that Stephen King were here today, okay? And suppose that Stephen King would walk here now along this path here. Then what's going to happen is at first a few people will accumulate around him, and then more would accumulate and so on. And so the inertia would become really substantial. That's what the Higgs field does, and that's how it gives mass to particles. Yes, you have a question?
Hi, thank you. You talk about your love of art. And I know that a lot of great minds are very drawn to art, do drawings, things like that. For example, Einstein, you know, they know that he did a lot of drawing.
He was a musician.
And I'm wondering if you see a connection between art and science, and if you can comment on perhaps the influence.
So I actually, let me tell you a few things in a somewhat philosophical, abstract way, and then some things in the practical way. Yes, you point out, although I don't know how you know this, maybe you read something about me, but or whatever, that, yeah, I am an art fanatic, and I own thousands of art books, yes. I like to say that that's because I have absolutely no talent in art, and so I... So the one thing that I do see in an abstract way as common is that both the artists and scientists are trying to give us in some way an image of the universe around us. And by that I mean all aspects of this universe. This includes human emotions and all that and so on. Only they come to this from very different perspectives. Now, in terms of the direct influences, I must actually say that those are very small. There are here and there some examples of people having been influenced this way or the other way. And it is certainly the case that, for example, I don't know, the Impressionists that, you know, like to paint light came about around the same period as all the great discoveries concerning light came about in physics. But it is not obvious that those things were particularly influential. It is also true that, you know, things like, Freudian psychology and the nature of dreams were influenced at some level or in the other way around by things like surrealism and so on. But the influences are not such that you can say, oh, if it wasn't for the other would not have existed. I don't think so. And I look among my scientist colleagues, and actually not many of them are the same kind of art fanatics that I am. Very few are. So I think both are needed to expand the minds, if you like. People sometimes ask me also about reading, you know. This is very unfortunate. You are all here, so I'm preaching to the choir. But people are reading less. And I don't mean reading less books in print. I don't care if somebody reads my book on a Kindle or on a this or a that, as long as they read. But people are reading less. There is no question about this, that people are reading less. And you say, so what? You know, and probably this is inevitable. And I imagine that in every generation in human history, somebody lamented something. But I do think that it has an effect in the following sense. You see, I don't know, take somebody like Kafka or somebody like this. And you read the description and people tell me, I don't have the patience to read this long description of what the room looked like and I don't know what. You know, because we have become accustomed to movies in which if there isn't an explosion every 2 seconds, it's boring, right? What is the benefit of having that description? I'll tell you what I think is that benefit, and I think that it is lost if you don't read. And that's the following, that I read that description, and I actually create in my mind a picture of that room. And you read that description, and you create in your mind a different description of that room. Which in both of our cases, if somebody instead showed us a picture of that room, it wouldn't be the same. I mean, that, you know, then we both see precisely the same thing. Plus the fact that by reading that description, it enhances your vocabulary, it enhances your imagination, and so on. So these effects are small, and maybe you cannot even grasp them at the level of, you know, reading one page or something like this. But I think there is a lot in that. And the same way, I think also a little bit about art, because two artists can see the same group of people here and can make a completely different work of art out of this. You know, while from a scientific perspective, these are all the people that I see here, you know, and so on. And one day, I'll even be able to connect a functional MRI to all of their brains and tell precisely what they are thinking. And most of them think right now, what is he talking about?
Yes, could you tell us a little bit about how you come up with your ideas for books? And also, it seems like that writing the book about the blunders took a lot of effort. You went to look at the papers of Darwin and so on. So it must have taken a lot of time and money to do this.
You're right. So first of all, it took me about 4 years to write Brilliant Blunders. And yes, I went to all the places and so on. And I do that for every book. Now, how do I come up with the book? I actually started by, I've been giving talks for years, you know, popular talks and so on. And at one point I said, wait a second, why don't I sit down and try to write a book? So my first book was called The Accelerating Universe, was at some level taking my day job and turning it into a book. And that was nice, but actually it wasn't as satisfying for me because then I did not actually need to do all this research that I like doing, you know, and so on. And this is why that was actually the only book that I wrote about my work. While I wrote that book, if you will actually read it, you will see that I mention in it some mathematical concept that appears also in the arts, which is the golden ratio. So I mentioned it in that book. And then once I finished that book, I said, you know what? I could write a whole book about that. And I wrote the golden ratio. The last chapter in the golden ratio, I have a section which I called Is God a Mathematician? That actually became my fourth book. The third book was because I realized that I love mathematics. There was no book about group theory, and there was a reason why there was no book about group theory. It's just very hard to write a popular book about group theory. So I decided to write one, and that was the equation that couldn't be solved. Brilliant Blunders, you know, I'm not actually sure how I came about thinking about that. Well, it was through this business that I thought that the way science is presented is incorrect. But in all my books, I traveled to the places. You know, when I wrote The Equation That Couldn't Be Solved, I did things about the life of Évariste Galois, a famous young French mathematician. I think I held in my hand every piece of paper ever written about Galois. By the way, I have to brag about this. There is no, you are not gonna prevent me from bragging about this. On my way to here today, I bought this at the railway station. This is the book review from the New York Times. And lo and behold, Brilliant Blunders is number 15 in the bestseller list. Thank you. By the way, I have a friend who's a very funny guy, and he read my book, and in the book I describe one of the characters that appears, well, not one of the main characters, but he appears in the DNA story with Linus Pauling, is Lawrence Bragg, who is a famous physicist. He and his father both got the Nobel Prize in physics. And Lawrence Bragg remains to this very day the youngest person to have ever received the Nobel Prize. Was 25 years old when he got the Nobel Prize in physics. So this friend of mine who read the book wrote me, you know, this guy got the Nobel Prize at 25. This is really something to brag about. His name was Lawrence Bragg, yes? Yes, please.
Good afternoon, doctor. My name's Lily Mae Wood. My question to you is, do you have a favorite blender in your book, or do you have a certain equation that you feel more drawn to than others? And if so, why?
I understood the equation. What was the first thing that I liked? What was my favorite what?
Blend.
I somehow don't hear you well.
Do you have a certain blender as far as...
blend of what with what?
Some of the theories that you've researched.
I see. Well, let me just say the following. In January of this year, there is a science writer for Scientific American. She used to work for space.com. Her name is Clara Moskowitz. She's a very good science writer. She actually conducted among many researchers. She wanted to make a list of what researchers considered the 11 most beautiful mathematical equations. And I proposed Einstein's equation for general relativity, And she published that as an article, and just by chance, my choice appears first in her list of 11. So I'd have to stick by that. Okay, I think we are basically out of time. Is that right? We have 1 minute, so maybe one quick question, if there is one.
I don't think you'll be able to answer this or talk about it in a minute, but I wondered if you might, you talked about science and art and trying to link them or answer the question. Everything you've been talking about has just got my mind bouncing around ideas. Is there a link, this is the way to simplify the question, is there a link or do you believe there's a link reflecting our thinking, how the human brain might work and our thinking between, let's say, linguistics, language, mathematics, the language of science?
There is no doubt. There is no doubt. There is no doubt. Yes. I mean, you know, Noam Chomsky, I mean, you know, has written extensively about these things and so on. Yes, there is no doubt that there are links of that sort. There are other kinds of links, too. I mean, there are links between, I gave once a TED talk about that. Curiosity, for example, when we're curious, the same regions in the brain light up as when we're hungry or when we face a conflict. On the other hand, when we satisfy the curiosity, the same regions in the brain light up as when we have the pleasure circuit, when we have good food or good wine or something like this. So yes, there definitely are. The way our brain works is very complex, and there are always these links. It's not that, okay, this part does this and that alone. It doesn't work that way. So just to say that, I mean, in the program here, I'm supposed to sign books between 1:30 and something, and I'm not sure where that is, but I have an escort here who will take me there. So if you want to come there, please, you're all invited. Thank you all very much.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.